It is truly a great honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. Shay Rozen, my dear brother, friend, educator, and researcher. We know each other for many years now, and I'm just giving you a brief introduction and give the floor to Shay. Shay was born and raised and lives in Israel. He's married, father of two sons, and lives in a small village about half an hour drive from Haifa, lucky man. Professionally, Dr. Shay Rozen is a tourist guide and currently teaches and trains other people in that profession. At the same time, he's engaged in research in various fields related to his areas of interest. He completed his undergraduate studies at the Open University and his master's and PhD in the Department of Land and Israel Studies at the University of Haifa. His master's and doctorate research dealt with the first 100 years of the Baha'i presence in the Holy Land, and we will hear later on about that. As a gift to himself, upon completion of his doctorate, he decided to try and visit every Baha'i shrine and house of worship around the world. And until now, he has visited all three temples, Acre, Haifa, and Montreal, and four houses of worship in India, Germany, Australia, and North America. From the early stages of his research, he started lecturing at international conferences and around the world on various aspects of his research, namely the Baha'i presence in Israel, the Baha'i woman pilgrims from the West, the Baha'is and the German Templars relationship, the influence of the Baha'i territories on shaping the borders between Israel and Syria and more. I will just tell you two little funny stories that he has related to me. He says when he was about 10 years old, his father was working in United Nations in Guyana, where he lived for 1 year. I'm quoting him now, it's not me. He said, I was blaming Guyanese local English language for my horrible accent and mistakes in English. Till he, in this platform, OZ Whitehead, he heard Terence Simmons, I think Terence is here and he's accepting Shay's confession. Simmons and Brian O'Toole speaking so eloquently in English, he realized that his problem with English language has nothing to do with Guyana. And the second anecdote is that when he was lecturing a non-Baha'i audience, the first question comes to the mind of the audience, who are the Baha'is? We have never heard of them. And when he has got a Baha'i audience, he has got another different problem. They say, what brings a good Jewish boy to talk about the Baha'i faith? Don't know our audience tonight, but I hope they will tell us later on what they think about Shay's talk tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Shay Rozen.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Farzin. It was excellent. I will add another story, if I may. About 10 years ago, when I started my research, I was invited to give a talk in Acuto in Italy, the Baha'i Center in Italy. And I went to the Baha'i Center and asked my friend, the Baha'is there in Haifa, what should I wear? Because Baha'i in Israel always wear tuxedos, suits, even in ties, even in the summer. So I went and I got a blazer, I think it was a jacket or something, and went to Acuto in August, very hot Acuto, and I waited for my friends, the Baha'i, to come. And then they came, everyone, with a Hawaiian shirt and slippers. So then I understand that knowing the Baha'is in Israel is not knowing the Baha'is. So, oh, the Baha'is with the funny hats and the funny clothes. This is my part of it. Before I start my talk, I would like to thank Kay, Steve, Farzin, Mujan, and all the friends that initiated the Oz Whitehead Firesides. Invite me to join it and allow me over the past year to enjoy almost every week, every Sunday in the middle of the night, a meeting with the Baha'i friends from all over the world. It was a unique opportunity to experience from the sideline the significance of a global Baha'i community, and I honor to present the last lecture in that blessed project. This is, and I will add another thing, this is the lecture that I gave for my first time to Baha'is in Akuto about 10 years ago. As most Baha'i know, there are two Baha'i areas in the Holy Land. The first area includes the city of Acre. It's a suburban, the Acre of the, in the Western Galilee, and in the center is the shrine of Baha'u'llah. And in the mention, and by mention, and the new shrine of Abdul Baha near the Rizwan Garden. The second center area included Haifa and the slopes of Mount Carmel, and in the center of it is the shrine of the Bab. My talk today will be focusing on the third Baha'i area, the Jordan Valley, about 60 kilometers east of Haifa. This area is located between, on a depth of about 200 meters below sea level, and extended to the shores of the Lake of Galilee between the slopes of the Golan Heights in the east and the parties of the Golan Mountain on the west. Four factors relevant to our case characterize this area. First, it is a hot, dry area with plenty of water resources, allowing agriculture growth that preceded the growing season in color in cooler areas. Secondly, it's a border area between the agricultural area and the nomad Bedouin territories. Third, this is the birthplace of Israeli joint agricultural settlement, the kibbutz. And the fourth, this is the border zone between English and French mandate after the First World War and between Israel and Syria after the Israeli War of Independence. During the Ottoman period, there were four main villages in this area: Nuqeib, Es-Samrā on the eastern bank of the Sea of Galilee, Samak in the south part, and Umm-Jūna on the west bank of the Jordan. These villages were abandoned in the mid-19th century by the residents as a result of Bedouin attacks and due to Ottoman authorities that failed to establish their rule in this area. Victor Guérin, the French explorer, described in 1875 those villages as, and I'm quoting each one of them, Nuqeib, remain of a small village built of basalt stones, Es-Samrā, ruined site that I've been said before, Samak, an Arab village that was a visit in 1870, and now it's abandoned. Guérin doesn't mention Umm-Jūna, but we can have every reason to believe that this village was also abandoned by its inhabitants. And in 80, and I'm going back and I see another map. Here's Nuqeib, Es-Samrā, Samak, and Umm-Jūna. In 1876, Abdul Hamid II, under the auspices of the Tanzimat reorganization movement, ascend the throne and become the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire. Under the reform influence, Abdul Hamid was forced to publish on the 19th, December 23rd, 1876, a new constitution to the empire known as the Kanun el-Asai, the basic law. That declares, and I'm quoting in some part of it, all subjects of the empire called Ottomans, without distinction whether faith they are professed. Every Ottoman enjoyed personal liberty. Personal liberty is all inviolable. No one can suffer punishment under any protect whatsoever. The state will protect free exercise of faith. All Ottomans are equal in the eyes of the law. They have the same rights and all the same duties toward their country without prejudice to religion. The importance of this statement to the Baha'i community within the Ottoman Empire should not be underestimated. The declaration gave the Baha'i freedom of worship, freed Baha'u'llah from its confinement to the walls of the city of Acre, and enabled the acquisition of Rizwan Garden and other real estate in the city and the area surrounded it. Another action credited to the new Sultan is the enforcement of central government over the empire periphery. That was achieved by setting new immigrants loyal to the Sultan near the borders and passed them against the local nomads. At the southern Syria, that is land of Israel, was part of it. Those new immigrants were the Adige tribes, known as the Circassians, which was famous as fearless warriors. The Circassians started to settle the Golan Heights and Transjordan in 1878, and in a few years, the security situation in this area improved dramatically. That improvement in the security situation influenced the resettlement of the villages in the Jordan Valley. Gottlieb Schumacher, the German researcher, reported in 1883 that on the eastern coast of Lake Galilee, there are two villages, Samak and Es-Samrā. The members of the Baha'i community of Acre at those years took the opportunities that the new Ottoman constitution gave them and started to purchase land plots and mansions wherever it was possible. The wide-scale, empty, and possibly cheap land plot in the Jordan Valley combined with the good new security situation make this area a good bargain. Starting in 1882, according to Baha'i tradition, the Baha'i community purchased land, large areas of land in the Jordan Valley. The purpose of this plot was basically to provide food to the urban Baha'i community at Acre. We should notice that the land plot that the Baha'i community purchased near Acre was small, and their main purpose was to give Baha'u'llah a place where he can live, relax, and be inspired by God. The source of money, although a comparatively small amount of few hundred pounds was required for the purchase of those properties, this was quoted from Lady Bloomfield, The Chosen Highway. But I'm looking for Baha'u'llah from Gleaning of Baha'u'llah. I won't read it all, but let's see what he said. I'm talking about people that want to donate money for the purpose, for the family. And he's saying, and dedicate the rich and scattered territories adjoining the Jordan and its vacancy to the worship and service of the one true God. So there is a source of money. Pilgrims that and believers that donate money and bought land in this area. The first land that the Baha'i community purchased in the Jordan Valley was the village of Es-Samrā. At 1882, according to Baha'i local tradition. To support this tradition, we can take the population survey that Gottlieb Schumacher published in 1889, when he wrote that in Es-Samrā there are 36 persons, 34 of them are Arabs, and 4 of them are Baha'is. On the ignoration of Schumacher from the Baha'is in the Acre area, it's emphasized to the Baha'i that Es-Samrā is significant and can be indicated the important position that those four Baha'is had at the village, probably the ownership of the land. Another village that the Baha'i, that Shumach mentioned in his survey was Nuqeib, in which he states it's a small, neglected village on the east shore of Lake Tiberias. The population is 20, among them 18 are Muslims. The other two inhabitants are probably Baha'is, as we know that around this time, Mirza Muhammad Kuli, Baha'u'llah's brother, bought some land in that area near the village and became the base for the small Baha'i community of Nuqeib. The Baha'i land purchase in Nuqeib continued, and we know, for example, that there was a competition between the Baha'is and the Jewish settlers of Bnei Yehuda, not far from there, to purchase about 1,390 dunams of land at Bir Ashgum on the mountain on the Golan Heights. Prior to Baha'i settlements at Es-Samrā and Nuqeib, a plot of land was bought in the by the Baha'is at Umm-Jūna, and Mirza Musa, as we know him, Akai Ikalam, Baha'u'llah's brother, settled there. When we examine the appearance of the Hushas, the mud huts at Umm-Jūna, the question that arose was why to use mud bricks when our local tradition is based on building by stones. The question disturbed me until I began to examine the typical construction in large parts of Iran. And it seems that, at least at the case of Umm-Jūna, there was a strong influence of the Iranian constitution tradition that was introduced to this area by the Baha'is. And if you want to equalize it, I got a picture from Iran, the same buildings. I never went to Iran. It's a one-way ticket. But hopefully in a few years, there will be peace and we can go there and can check this idea by itself. According to Mirza Musa's children, the land of Umm-Jūna was divided between Mirza Musa and Baha'u'llah. We can assume that the Baha'i lands at Es-Samrā and Nuqeib were also divided between Baha'u'llah and his brothers. Although we don't know exactly what the parameter of the Baha'i's properties of the journal was in 1922, when Baha'u'llah passed away, we have sufficient clues to assume that it was thousands of dunams that stretched from Nuqeib to the north, although along the shores of Lake Tiberias to Umm-Jūna at the west. Imagine the map, all this area. Abbas Effendi, known as Abdul Bahat, or Baha'is and me, Baha'u'llah's older son and the bearer of the lead, as the leadership of the Baha'i community, continued to develop the Baha'i properties on the Jordan Valley. Schumacher, that was mentioned before, stated in 1899 that at Kalat al-Hassan, the archaeological site of the old Ipus city, Abbas Effendi el-Babi built a warehouse and two huts for the Baha'is of Es-Samrā. And in 1913, he wrote, at Es-Samrā, the change only a little, there were 40 huts and some public buildings. The residents are growing vegetables. At Nuqeib, there are three huts, vegetable garden, and four gardens on the bay, on the beach. The land belonged to Abbas Effendi el-Babi. The Baha'is plant orchards of peaches, apples, pomegranates, figs, oranges, and lemons. The fruit and vegetables that grow those gardens are sent by the train to Haifa and Damascus. But the most important change in the Baha'i settlement at the Jordan Valley at the time of Abbas Effendi, was the selling of land at Umm-Jūna to the Jewish Colonization Association, the GCA, in 1903, and the establishment of the village of El-Adasiye and the banks of the Yarmuk River. As mentioned before, part of the Baha'i's land that Umm-Jūna was belonged to Mirza Musa Akai Ikalam, Baha'u'llah's brother. After he passed away, Mirza Mujahideen Din, his son, inherited those lands and in 1903 sold them, covering an area of 3,000 dunams to the Jewish Colonization Association and the result of the land in 1903 to the Keren Kayemet Israel, a GNSF. The Keren Kayemet tried to buy the second half of the land from Abbas Effendi itself by Felden, and in 1910 established a kibbutz called Deganya Aleph, the first kibbutz on those lands. The founders of Deganya wrote a few years later, "We have a good relation with the owner of the land, probably Mujahideen. He was a Baha'i, a middle-aged, unmarried nobleman. He lived in a mud hut like we did. Sometimes he would invite us to a cup of coffee. Probably it was not true Baha'i, because if it was a Baha'i, we'll invite him to a cup of tea. But okay, we managed with coffee. And by the way of conversation, talk about the principle of the Baha'i religion. He has a small garden that he watered from the Jordan. In his garden, fruit trees and ornament trees and flowers and a bathing area on the banks of the Jordan. It was a paradise. Like Rizwan near Akko. I read this paragraph and I asked myself, if it is possible that some of the Baha'i principle have penetrated into the ideology of the kibbutz movement. Is it possible that the principle of equality between men and women, between members of the community, the joint discussion on daily life, the value of everyone works as he can and receive as he needs, also fed on Baha'i sources and not only on local invention? Think about it. It's a part that we're going to do a research in a few years, planning to do it. In 1901, Abbas Effendi bought the area of 9,200 dunams from a local Bedouin sheikh on the banks of the Yarmouk River, and 6 years later invited Baha'is from Iran to immigrate to those lands. Those immigrants, most of them Baha'is from Zoroastrian origin from the city of Yazd, established a village on those land and named it El-Adasiye and Urbeth on Baha'i principles. In 1940, at the eve of Well, First World War, the Baha'i Church of the Jordan Valley was at its peak. It consisted of 4 Baha'i villages and farms that spread over thousands of dunams of land and produced good crops of fruit and vegetables. The crop was so successful that during 2 weeks in 1970, by the orders of Abbas Effendi, more than 200 camels loaded with wheat were sent to Haifa to feed the starving population of the city. It's a story that everybody knows. According to the Baha'i narrative, for feeding the poor Haifa with wheat from the Baha'i settlement in the Jordan Valley at the end of the First World War, Abbas Effendi received the title of nobility from the King of Britain and became known as Sir Abbas. Surprisingly, there are no mention of this story in the Baha'i documents dealing with the coronation of Abdul Baha'i Sir Abbas, and the question therefore may be how it have to be sought in other circumstances. Remember one thing, there is history and there is story. There's a Baha'i narrative and there are documents. And I consider them both as two wings of one bird. It can't fly with one, bird can't fly with one wing. So we have the history, the facts, and we have the narrative, even though it sometimes seems a bit different. Why Abdul Baha was received, according to documents, the title of Sir Abbas? After the war, during negotiation between the Great Britain and French Republic on the balance between the forthcoming British and French mandate, in response to the French mandate, demands that the Golan Heights, which belong to the Amir Faour, will be part of the French mandate. And I'm looking at the map. According to the first negotiation, this is the border. The Golan Heights will be divided between French and Britain, and the Sea of Galilee will be divided also between the French and British mandate. So the French asked, they say, we want all the Golan Heights. So Winston Churchill, the British Colonial Secretary, said, I want all that area that belongs to Sir Abbas should be a part of the British mandate. And I'm arguing that to achieve this goal of getting all the Lake of Tiberias as part of the British mandate, Sir Abbas Effendi was crowned as a sir. Now he's part of the British Empire. It's not a single man. It's not so a man of another religion. He's part of the British Empire, and we want him as part of our mandate, as Church as our mandate. The result of this order was including of the southeast Lake of Tiberias as part of Palestine mandate and determined the path of the international border. Another result of the British mandate was the separation between the Baha'i community at El-Adasiye from the community of Palestine, what we now call Eretz Israel. And look at this map. This is the new and the border between French and British mandate, Israel and Syria until 1967. And you can see that here, this area is the Baha'i properties exactly. The borders of the Baha'i properties of Sir Abbas. During the year between the death of Abbas Effendi in 1921 and the 1948 war, the Baha'i properties of the Jordan Valley started its decline. The beginning was that process started with the separation of the village of El-Adasiye Baha'is from the rest of the Baha'i communities in Acre. It was continued with the sale of the remains of the land at Umm-Jūna to the current community Israel in the 90s and 20s, part of the land of Nuqeib to the Kidmat Kinneret group at the 30s and part of the area of Es-Samrā in the 40s. On July 6, 1937, kibbutz Ein Gev was established near the Baha'i farm at Nuqeib. Now I want to look at this map. You can see the Baha'i farm over here. You can see the new kibbutz. And look over here, there's a new small Baha'i cemetery. One is there, one is over here. This cemetery will be the focus of another lecture, of another part of my talk later. A few years after starting in this place, a group of Ein Gev members went to visit Baha'i community of El-Adasiye in order to learn how to sustain agriculture and the condition of that area. They describe the experience of the visit in the words. At the entrance to the village was a beautiful bellwood of acacia trees, to which we are seeing diverse fruit tree gardens and beautiful vineyards. Most of the land is planted with gardens and orchards of pomegranates of various varieties. We moved to a vineyard. There are different varieties. Everything is arranged on cordons and beautiful pussies. From there, we reached the fruit trees, pineapple, apple of all varieties, pears, guava. We saw bananas standing in the water, half a meter high. In the orchard, there are two variants of golden oranges, grapefruits, mandarins, lemons. In the corner of the farm, there is a cane and some vegetables. In conclusion, we saw a perfect mixed farm. There are almost all the fruit trees in the world. They come from Persia. They all make a living from farming. The foundation of the religion is Aritekleira. Okay, it's not the base of religion, but this is what they understood. Talking about work at the in Ideal, remind us quite a bit of Aaron David Gordon, the big ideologue of the kibbutz movement. We visited the club, a wonderful building surrounded by gardens and fruit trees and ornaments to glory. It is difficult to describe that in such a remote corner there's such wealth and beauty. What he's talking about is this building. This is the club, the community office of El-Adasiye. We saw it before, it was one story high. Now they build another story. During the 1948 war, the area of the southeast shores of Lake Tiberias became a battlefield between the Israelis and the Syrian armies. During the war, the members of the Baha'i community of Es-Samrā and their tenant farmers fled from the area to Syria and Lebanon, and the Baha'is of Nuqeib were ordered by the local HaHagana commander to evacuate their farm, and they left for Acre and Haifa. After the war, the question of this area raised in the Israeli-Syrian armistice talks. Part of this area west to the border and between Nuqeib and Es-Samrā was held by the Syrian army after the war, and so demanded that this area will be held as a demilitarized zones and that the civilian residents should return to their villages. Israel, on the other hand, did not desire those people, most of them Muslims from Syria, mainly Arabs, will return to the territory, started to determine facts and establish Jewish settlements in this area. On August 1949, a group of Nahal fighting pioneer corps youth settled at Es-Samrā and founded kibbutz Aron. Most of the kibbutz land were leased from the Baha'i owners. Most of them belonged to the common breakers sect. And along the 1950s, those land were bought by the State of Israel and become Israeli lands. The lands balance at Nuqeib were exchanged on agreement between the Baha'i owners and the State of Israel in 1944 for lands near the Shrine of Baha'u'llah at Bahaji near Akko. And if you know Bahaji, you've been to Bahaji, this was the original estate. They mentioned all this area and the olive trees belong to the village. Our village was changed between Israel and the Baha'is. Instead of the land in Gev. The last episode of the story of Baha'i presence, although some small portion of land at the area of Samak and Al-Hama was under Baha'i ownership until after 1955, the Israeli purchases of El-Samrā and Nuqeib can be considered the end of the Baha'i settlement in the Israeli Jordan Valley. The story of El-Adasiye at the Jordan side of the Yarmuk ended in the 1960s when the inhabitants of the village, the last Baha'i settlement in the area, left the village and spread all over Jordan. The Baha'i settlement in the Jordan Valley became an unknown part of the local and Israeli history, and all that remained was a small Baha'i cemetery at Kibbutz Ein Gev and some old memories. The last episode in the story of the Baha'i presence in the Jordan Valley took place on October 18, 1985, when, in collaboration between the Universal House of Justice and Kibbutz Ein Gev, the remains of Mirza Muhammad Kuli and his family were reburied in a new Baha'i cemetery ignited into the foot of the Golan Heights. One member of the kibbutz recorded his impression of this event. The ceremony exceeded exemplary organization and planning. Uniformed ushers directed the crowd and hand out plans. But above all, someone stood out in special atmosphere. Men in ties and wearing black suits. I have to say, it's the Jordan Valley. It's summer. It's very, 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 very hot place. Many, and you know, understand, this is how I look in Israel. People with ties and even in the summer. And lavishly dressed ladies stand still in the hot sun and held colorful umbrellas. The covers of the tombs and the wall area was decorated with flowers according to the best of the Baha'i tradition. When our delegation arrived, we stopped wide-eyed at the sight of the unusual picture in the landscape. Imagine the kibbutz members, working clothes, no ties, no suits, no jackets, seeing the Baha'is, imagine it. The audience watched in silence and clear pass to, and the coffin rested on the stage on a green Persian rug. Now begin a series of elegies and tribute to the saint who accompanies his brothers throughout his hardship and suffering. Afterward, praying and hymns in Arabic and Persian were chant. But the most important speech was heard in English from the widow of Shagui Fendi, Amatul Baya Rukhiya Khanum, the last leader of the religion. Most of the participants left the ceremony feeling that they were witnessing a historical event. This is the end. So thank you very much for everything and hope to see you soon in the Holy Land.
Thank you very much, Shai. Steve, that was wonderful, really fascinating.
Shai, that was absolutely wonderful. Thank you. Funny enough, when you came to the Association of Baha'i Studies a couple of years ago in Oxford, I was working on the day you spoke, and my wife said, "You missed the most wonderful talk." I met you the following day, but I had never heard. Becky told me a few things you'd said, but the reality exceeds even her eloquence.